that map. Now here is Arkentool.
As I remember, that should be on the left, and I don't remember.
It is. And here is Braymore.
Should be on the right.
It is. Now, where the hell are we?
What's in the middle?
Nothing.
That's where we are.
In nothing.
Sure. And for a fellow with my potentiality, this is an ideal location. We'll find our way out when the sun comes up.
Fine couple of game hunters we are. We come all the way over here from New York. And first night out, we get lost.
Maybe we took the high road instead of the low road. Here, would you like a drink?
No, thanks.
Good, that leaves more for me.
Hey, I thought you told me you were going to cut down on that stuff.
Yes, I did, but I'm a terrible liar. Besides, it doesn't pay. I remember one time, I was going with this wonderful girl, and she used to plead at me to give it up. So one day I did. Then we discovered we'd nothing more to talk about, so we broke up.
There's something about this place that gives me the feeling of being in the cathedral.
If we were, I'd know where the exit was.
You don't believe in anything, do you?
Of course I do.
Really? Why?
Factually, anything I can understand, you know. Anything that's real to me. Like things I can touch, taste, hear, see, smell, and swallow.
And what about the things you don't understand?
I dismiss them.
That makes life very easy, doesn't it?
Comfortable is the word.
I envy you, Jeff.
Why?
You seem so very satisfied with life.
I am, aren't you?
No, I'm not.
That's the silliest thing I ever heard. You've got a fine job, and you're engaged to a fine girl, and you're lost in a fine forest. What more do you want?
I don't know, but something seems wrong. Especially with Jane and me, and that makes everything seem wrong. Look how I keep postponing getting married. I just can't get myself to that altar.
I don't know what could be wrong about it. She's young, attractive, fits smack into your niche in life. And on top of that, she loves you. And just the proper amount, too.
And what is the proper amount?
Enough to make you happy, and not enough to embarrass your friends.
Sounds ideal, doesn't it? Well, why don't I see it that way? I must be lacking somewhere.
Now don't start talking yourself into an inferiority. You don't deserve it.
What do you mean?
Well, most of my friends with inferiority complexes are absolutely right. They're not as good as everyone else. But someone like you, who... I'm gonna say. Well, laddies, I hope you'll buy me out. Tis meant to be classy.
Charge of things, doesn't he, Miss Fiona?
Aye, especially after everything's been done. Would you have a way of stopping this thing if it's done?
I think so, Miss Fiona.
Hello, Harry.
Hello, Jean.
Tuam today.
How do you expect me to be? It's a wedding day, isn't it?
I'm truly sorry, Harry.
did Angus say, Harry? I forgot.
Hello, Harry.
Hello, Fiona. It just isn't fair for Charlie Cameron to be wedding Eugene. He's got everything. University of Edinburgh and now you. And I've got nothing.
Harry, here, take this cloth and house and see if there's a waistcoat over there.
Nothing but be doing this all my life.
And why didn't you pay attention like everything? He knows she's a yearning for you.
Aye, father.
Oh, Fiona, I feel so sorry for him. I know, darling. Mr. Ritchie, he's in the hate for not loving Harry, you.
No, Miss Jean, it's not your fault. I sometimes think the only person that could have loved Harry and helped him was his mother, rest her soul. Come, Jean.
You'll be staying with your father today. And Fiona, you'll be sure to buy everything that's needed for the wedding.
I will, father.
Remember, just what's needed. My intention on this occasion is to be hospitable, not philanthropic.
Mr. Ritchie, you'll send the waistcoat to the house.
Aye, Miss Fiona.
Good morning, Fiona. Hello, Meg. A jug of cream, please.
Mr. McMurray, if you could please, there's a lad for you for a change.
Why? Will the lads come shopping?
They look so poor. I should have had to ask them for money.
But you'll never make a profit doing that.
No, but I think I'll have to train.
Fiona, is it for the wedding? When are you going to be thinking of marriage for yourself?
Oh, when I find someone who makes me think of it.
What do you mean? You haven't found anyone up till now who makes you think of it.
No, you see, I didn't want to just get married. I think you should only do it when you and your lad want to stay together fiercely. And getting married is the only way to do it that's respectable.
That's a queer notion, Fiona.
Marry, I think everyone knows.
Hello.
Greetings.
Could you tell us where we are?
Of course we can tell you. You're at Brigadoon.
Brigadoon?
Aye.
That's funny. There's no Brigadoon on the map.
I shouldn't have been surprised.
You mean you know it isn't on the map?
Aye.
It's a little snobbish of you, don't you think? And why isn't it on the map?
For a good and sound reason.
What are you all dressed up for? Is this the day you take pictures for postcards?
Me am not dressed up.
You mean you always walk around with all these clothes on?
No.
Now come on, somebody. What's going on here? What is this?
We're having a fair.
Oh, is that milk you're selling there?
Aye.
Can I buy some? I'm thirsty. We've been walking all night.
I'll have to see your money first.
What? What do you give him?
A hunk of uranium?
Just a shilling. What a loony layout business.
This belly interests himself. Which is of no use to me.
What do you mean it's of no use to you? Sell me something and it will be.
I'm sorry, but I can't sell you on.
However, if you're thirsty, I'll give you a drink.
Never mind, I don't want any favor.
I think from the colony from England.
No, we're from America.
You're American.
I am. He's from Brooklyn. Come on.
No, wait, please. We didn't mean to behave so strangely. We're just a wee bit taken aback. People don't come here very often.
I can understand why. You people stare at us as if we just dropped in from another world. Does that amuse you?
Aye, very much. Quiet, Meg.
They say every village has one.
If you've been walking all night, you must be tired and hungry. Would you not like something to eat and perhaps a place to lie down before you start back?
Well, that's very nice of you. Thank you.
Good. Oh, my name's Fiona McKee.
I'm Tommy Albright. And this is Jeff Douglas.
How do you do, sir? I make Rocky.
I'm glad you're happy about it.
There's a way in around the corner where you can get some food. I take you to it.
Go ahead. I'll be along in a minute. I want to phone the hotel first.
Is Meg going to take care of you, sir?
I'm afraid so. Why?
Well, I've some terrible troubles here, and I have to leave the inn. If Miss Meg should take some place to rest, and if you happen to rip your own thistle, I'd be more than happy to replace them for you.
Thanks, old man, but I don't expect to get stuck.
Keep in the car, laddie, but you're stuck now.
Yes, thanks to yourself, Mr. Ritchie.
What a place. Is there a phone around here?
A phone?
Yes.
I don't think we have one.
No phone?
No, sir.
Tell me, what's so strange about this place?
Nothing, sir. You're the one who...
Charlie! Here's a bottle of claret. Have a drop of good luck with me.
Well, the main bridegroom himself.
Right.
Good morning, darling.
Hi.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
He's marrying me sister this evening.
Oh.
Charlie, this is Tommy Albright. He just wandered by a wee while ago.
What? Oh, why, of course. Welcome, dear sir.
Welcome.
Here's your drink, Charlie.
Thank you, Angus.
And how about you, sir? Some claret.
Thanks. I think I'll drink this one to Mr. Forsyth. I just hope he knows how grateful I am for him postponing the miracle for me.
The what?
And may God bless me this evening, as much as I will bless him, if I were he, and he were Charlie Cameron.
What did you just say about postponing a miracle?
Tis a toast we have here.
Drink it down, I'll explain to you later.
Say, that's wonderful. May I have another?
That was a wedding gesture, sir. From now on, it is for sale only.
Thanks, anyway.
I must buy some claret for the wedding. Come with me, and you can have some more.
Fine.
Woman, tartans!
Is it not, lad? John.
Aye, it's a queer language. bear speaking.
I wonder what American women are like.
Mustn't no wonder about women anymore, Angus. I'm not allowed to.
Why, that's right, Jerry. You're finishing the last good word, haven't you?
I used to be a woman lad, woman and wondering life I had, but any lass I found who would try to tie me down. But then one day I saw a maid, held out her hand and I stayed and stayed, and now across the green, I'll go home with Bonnie June.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie June. Go home, go home,
I'll go home with Bonnie June. I used to have 100 friends, with me I wedded the friendship friends, they never come to war, so farewell to one and all. Farewell to all the lads I knew, I'll see them again when they're married too, for soon across the green, I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home,
I'll go home with Bonnie Jean. I used to know a lass with an air and her name was Jo, and every night at 10 I would meet her in the glen. Now I'll not see her again, especially not in the glen at 10. For now across the green I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home,
I'll go home with Bonnie Jean. How go to marry men I've known, soon have a wife and leave yours alone. A bonny wife indeed, and she's all I'll ever need. With Bonnie Jean my days will fly, and love her I will till the day I die. That's why across the green I'll go home with Bonnie Jean.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home, go home, go home, go home, go home.
About getting married.
Is it so unusual?
I think it is. Look at me. I'm not exactly bubbling over like Charlie, and next month I'm facing the minister.
You're getting married?
Yes.
Oh.
Oh, what?
I'm very surprised. Somehow you didn't seem the sort of lad who'd want to settle down.
I didn't say that. I just said I was getting married.
If you feel like that, why are you?
Because the girl wants to.
Is that reason enough?
I think it is. I don't know how it is in the Highlands, but in my neighborhood, if you've been going out with a girl for a while and she decides she wants to get married, you better agree right away and save yourself a lot of trouble.
Why?
Because if you don't, she'll either torment you so you'll marry her for a week, or she'll be so sweet about it, she'll make you feel guilty and your conscience will make you do it.
I must say, it doesn't sound like you love her very much.
It doesn't, does it?
And it sounds like a very peculiar place you come from.
Well, believe me, lass, this isn't your usual hamlet off the highway either. All that business about Charlie and the man who postponed the miracle.
Oh, that... I'm sorry, I can't say.
But you said you'd tell me later.
I know, but I can't say.
Fine. You know, if I hang around this village for long enough, I'd probably find out that everybody in it is slightly nutty. Is that possible?
I can't say.
Why not?
Because I didn't ken what nutty means.
It means slightly insane.
Well, then I can assure you, we're far from insane. We're the most blessed folk, and I never realize how fortunate we are until I meet an outsider. I mean, a stranger to Brigadoon. I didn't ken anything about you. But from the little you've said, I've heard everything you think I think differently about. And I'm quite certain that
like me very much, do you?
That's the funny part. I like you very much. I just don't like anything you say.
Fiona.
Aye?
If I stick around here until this evening, will you take me to the wedding?
Why do you suddenly want to go?
I can't say.
Well, I'll take you, and I'll be highly pleased to be there.
You will? Why?
Because of what I told you. I like you very much.
That's right. You did say that, didn't you?
Now, I'll show you some place where you can lie down and rest.
Why, what are you going to do?
Gather some heather for the wedding.
Where do you do that?
On the hill, where the heather is.
May I go with you?
No, I'll do it much faster alone.
I won't bother you. Really? Maybe I'm the one who's slightly nutty, but...
Can't we two go walking together out beyond the valley of dreams, out where the hillside of heaven curtsying gently in the breeze? That's what I like. Amazing in the gloaming, and all the clouds are holding still. So take my hand and we'll go roaming through the thunder on the hill. The morning dew is waking yonder.
Thank you.
very picturesque view of the glen.
Thank you.
What for?
Why, I like a bit of brush. It makes me very happy.
You get happy very easily, don't you? You know, I haven't been in an open space like this since I was a boy. Which at this point seems like a good 2,000 years ago.
You mean you're tired?
Aye, lassie, I'm tired. That's why you brought me here, isn't it? So I could take a nap?
I wouldn't think a long walk, but maybe a young lad like you.
A young lad?
Aye, you're very young.
That's either a deliberate lie or wishful thinking. I'm ancient, decrepit, and disintegrating rapidly.
Aye.
What's over here, a rock garden?
My father used to sleep in it.
That's his second mistake.
He and my mother met here. You see, my mother was a gypsy, and one day she was walking past, and she saw my father asleep here. Well, she liked the look of him, and she was a wee bit tired anyhow. So, she took off her shoes, sat down, and waited for him to wake up. It wasn't long after that I was born.
That's one of the sweetest bedtime stories I ever heard.
Are you sure you're comfortable?
Very. Thank you very much. You've been more than kind. And now, if you want to round out your generosity, buzz off.
You're a raw, handsome lad.
You should see me when I'm rested. I'm almost robust.
Leave it.
You're better. When I sleep, I make all sorts of odd noises.
What's so talking? Do you have a wife?
No, but I was engaged once.
What happened to the lass you were engaged to?
She fell in love with a Russian.
A Russian?
Yes.
Russia's in Europe, isn't it?
Yes, more and more.
Oh.
It's not far from here. You just cross the channel and turn left.
Aye, you're a winning lad. A right winning lad.
Now look here, lass. I don't know what you're after, but I don't want to. I want to go to sleep.
But don't you see? I'm highly attracted to you.
Thank you very much. When I wake, we'll discuss the whole problem. And believe me, you have a problem.
Now, when I look at you lying there, I see me tadpoles jumping up and down my spine.
That's about as repulsive an idea as I've heard in years. You know, if sex were a hobby, you'd be a collector's item.
I've been waiting so long.
Go.
Huh? You men are all alike.
I should certainly hope so.
You're all spruce. You get what you want from a lass, and then to farewell.
Get what I want? I can't even get you to go away.
That's what I mean. I thought you were interested in me, and that's why you got me to take me here. You misled me.
You certainly have one hell of an imagination. Can you think of one good reason why I, a strange man, should be interested in you, a strange woman, and at this hour of the day?
Of course I can, because you're a lad, and I'm a lass.
With that philosophy, you must have had a provocative career.
I've had a great many heartbreaks.
I don't doubt it at all.
At 16 years, I was so sad. Then father said I should find a lad. So I said, wife and found the real love of my life. His name, it was Chris, and the last was McGill. I met him one night, picked his flowers on the hill. He had lots of charm and a certain kind of touch, and a certain kind of eagerness that pleased me very much. So there, beneath the moon, where romance often dreams, I gave him my heart and a few other things. I don't that we stayed upon the hill, but the moon had disappeared, and so I drifted upon McGill. So I went home and I thought I'd die, till father said, make another try. So I set out to become a wife and found the great love of my life. He came from the lowlands, it seemed. I saw him and knew he was perfect for me. And it always will. What he told me, he had heard about his promise from McGill. We fell in love and
that laddie's the one who's never won as low. Now I told Father the awful truth. He said, what difference you got on you? So out I went to become a wife and found the real love of my life. Now he was a poet, the rhymer was he. He read me some verse, he had written for me. He said that they moved me, these poems from his pen, and the writing was because it moved me right into the glen. We stayed till the dawn came and light in the sky. Then I shook his hand and I bid him goodbye. I never went back, for what I had heard was true, that a poet only writes about the things he can do. Now Pa said, look out for men who sing. You'll be more certain with men who drink. So out I went to become a wife and found a ring. Was a soldier of fine Highland son. He told me about all the battles he'd won. He wasted his time telling me about his mind, and one look at him decided me to knock the double fight. We skirmished for hours at night in the glen, and I found the sword had more might than the pen. But when I was drowned and I saw to my dismay, and he thought it was a bugle and got up and marched away. Now Pa said, daughter, there must be one, someone who after all to run. So I'm still looking to be a wife and find a real love of my
everybody. some other body for dinner. What else could I do? What could anyone do but hate when you realize your life didn't mean a damn? I kind of leave here. I kind of go to university and make something of myself. And I kind of have Jeannie. So there's nothing left to do but hate everything and everybody in this cursed village.
You'll never find any peace by hating that. It only shuts you off from the world. And this is only a cursed village if you make it so. To the rest of us, this is a blessing to it.
Well, you can keep it. Well, that's that done. Who's that?
You waistcoat, Tim.
Oh. Don't have to be laddie, you'll spoil him. You can hardly wait for the wind. Jeannie!
They told me I can't be fooled. Wedding music starts playing to ease my longing. Nothing wrong in me standing out here and saying, come to Ben, kiss me good day. Now, my darling, is all I can say. Just come to Ben, kiss me. I'm burning to shout my yearning, the words gone tiptoeing at me. Oh, come, then, kiss me good day. Now, my darling, 'tis all I can say. Just come, then.
You should have seen the apartment I got, complete with a built-in lassie. Come on in. What kind of... What the hell happened to you? Pistols. What? Never mind, it's a professional secret. Mine will be ready before we leave. And another thing. Disregard all that rubbish about Scottish frugality. Their generosity is overpowering. Well, tell me, how do you feel? Surprisingly well. How about you? I never felt better in my life. Maybe the sun gave me the power, for I could not grow and then be home in half an hour. Maybe the air gave me the drive, for I'm all the glow and alive. Almost like we a bell that is ringing for me. And from the way that I feel when that bell starts to peal, I would swear I was falling. I could swear I was falling. It's almost like being in love. When we walked up the bridge,
not a word did we say. It was almost like being in love. With your lips in mine, never was kind of fine.
It was almost like being in love.
All you that life seemed to be,
like a bell that is ringing for me. And from the way that I feel when the bell starts to peal,
I could swear I was falling.
I could swear I was falling. She's marrying?
They told me at the tavern, some guy named Cameron.
Well, guess this. Marry Jean McKee to Charlie McCorley Cameron, May 24th, 1746. Now what do you say?
Congratulations.
Wait a minute. No Brigadoon on the map. No telephones in the whole town. Thanks to Mr. Somebody for doing something about a miracle. And three or four other things that I passed over when I was out with Fiona this afternoon.
That hyperthyroid I was with never heard of Johnny Walker.
I don't understand it. I'm beginning to feel a little like a damn fool.
What are you getting so worked up about? If it makes them happy to disregard 200 years of human bing-bang, let them.
But I've just spent the most wonderful day of my life. And now I run into something like this. It just doesn't make sense to me.
It does to me. It just means that baddie people relax you.
She is not. She can't be. Fiona! There must be some logical explanation. Even logical enough for you. Fiona! Fiona!
You don't have to explain anything to me. I don't care.
Tommy, what is it?
Come here.
What is it, Tommy?
Is this your name here in this Bible?
I? Why? Oh.
Someone seems to have been fiddling with books.
Well, come on, is there an explanation or isn't there? I'd like to know.
There is, but I cannot tell you.
Well, is there anybody who can? I'd like to know that too.
You must talk with the Dominie.
The who?
Our schoolmaster, Mr. Murdoch.
Where does he live?
Down the road, in a tree.
He does not live in a tree, Mr. Douglas. Mr. Murdoch's a great man. All right, Tommy, I'll take you to him. I have no wants to, because I was hoping we could have this day together.
Why What has that got to do with it?
God, we're so happy to believe that you're here. You think there's something wrong with us, and you leave. I know it.
And maybe I will, and maybe I won't. Come on, Jack. Is it informal, or should I wear my three-cornered hat? I said, come on. Happened 200 years ago. 200 years ago, the Highlands of Scotland were plagued with witches. They were horrible, destructive women. I don't suppose you have such women in your world.
Witches?
Yes, we still have them. We pronounce it differently, though. Aye. It didn't matter. They went out with those references. Because you and I know that there is no such thing. Their influence is very real indeed. Now, here in Brigadoon, we had a minister of the Kirk named Mr. Forsyth. And a good man he was.
The kindest man in Scotland.
No man ever loved his parish as did Mr. Forsyth. But he was grown old, and it wearied and it troubled him. One day soon, he would leave all those who were dear to him. But most of all, he worried about the witches. They hadn't come to Brigadoon yet, but he knew that there was a wheen of them on their way. And he began to wonder if there wasn't something he could do to protect the folk of the parish. Not just from the witches, mind you, but from all the evils that might come to Brigadoon from the outside world after he was dead.
What a kind man.
For many days, he walked through the glen thinking, and if he had passed his house at any hour of the night, you'd have seen the candles lit and Mr. Forsyth sitting in his chair thinking. And then, one day he came to me and told me he had decided to ask God for a miracle.
Pastor's so nice, I cry thinking about it.
He consulted with me because he knew I had a highly logical mind. And he reckoned that as long as he was asking for a miracle, it might as well be a well-organized miracle. So for many days I walked through the glen with him, and for many nights I sat with him by candlelight. And finally, Mr. Forsyth decided what he was going to ask for. And on Wednesday morning, he went out to the hill beyond Brigadoon and made his prayer to God. And there, in the hush of a sleeping world, he asked God that night to make Brigadoon vanish into the Highland mist. Vanish, but not forever. It will all return, just as it was, for one day, every 100 years. The folk will go on leading their customary life, but when they awoke the next morning, it will be 100 years later. And when we woke the next morning, it was 100 years later. My God! You see, In this way, Mr. Messiah believed there'd be no change in the lives of the people. They just wouldn't have been in any sanctuary long enough to be affected by it.
You mean, you go to bed at night, and when you get up the next morning, it's 100 years later?
Aye.
Then every day is 100 years later?
Aye.
What happened to the minister?
We never saw him again. You see, he realized to ask for such a miracle, some sacrifice would have to be made. And he wanted to be the one to make that sacrifice. Now, what would be the greatest sacrifice he could offer? To be separated before his time from the folk of the parish whom he loved. Which is why he went out to the hill beyond Brigadoon. With a miracle granted, he would never see Brigadoon again.
And all this happened 200 years ago.
Aye, lad, which is only 2 days ago to us.
Mr. Forsyth had intended asking for the miracle on Tuesday,
but young Charlie Cameron was away in the university at Edinburgh and wasn't expected back till late on Tuesday night. And Mr. Forsyth, not wanting anything to go wrong with the miracle or with the wedding, phoned praying till Charlie got back.
Was that not sweet of him?
Let me ask you something. Supposing somebody from around here gets fed up and wants to leave, then what?
Oh, he can't leave.
You mean I've got to stay here now?
No, that. But according to Mr. Forsyth's contract with God, if anyone of Brigadoon leaves, then the enchantment is broken for all.
And
that night, when the folk of the parish go to sleep, Brigadoon will disappear forever.
Look, I'm not saying I believe all that stuff, but let's just say for argument's sake, a stranger, like, well, me, came to Brigadoon and wanted to stay. Could he?
No, I not. Mr. Forsyth provided for that.
He didn't miss a trick, did he?
No, lad. He did not. A stranger can stay if he loves someone here. Not just Brigadoon, mind you, but someone in Brigadoon. Which is, after all, lad, how it should be. Because after all, if you love someone deeply, anything is possible.
I think I like that part the best.
Should you not be thinking about dressing for the wedding?
I had. Tommy, will I see you later?
Yes, I'll be there.
Thank you, Tommy.
I think I want to stick around and see if this place evaporates like you say.
I will tell you now. Good day, Mr. Murdoch.
She's a dear lass.
Yes, I'm finding that out. Tell me, Mr. Murdoch, you're all perfectly happy living in this little village?
Aye, lad, of course. I try to peek through a small hole.
But at night, when you're asleep, what's it like?
Well, for me, it's like being carried on shadowy arms to some far-off cloud and there float till morning. And yet, sometimes I think I hear strange voices.
Voices?
Aye, voices. They say no words I can remember, but their voices are filled with a fearful longing, and they seem to be calling me back. I ponder this when I'm awake, and I think I have a feeling I'm here in the outside world. There must be lots of folk out there who'd like a Brigadoon. It is time for the wedding.
Thank you.
There's going to be a wedding. We have no minister in Brigadoon now. In most villages, that would be a calamitous thing. But here, we know it is a blessing. When there is no minister present, it is perfectly proper, according to the laws of Scotland, for two people to be wed by sincere mutual consent. There need be nothing in writing. All that's required is the promise of love for as long as you both are enough. Go ahead, lad.
I shall love you till I die, and I'll make every effort to be a good husband.
Mr. Forsyth, I know what it's like to have been here. But if you'll both be good and true to each other, then you can't help but live with the grace of God. And Mr. Forsyth could have asked no more than that.
Are we married now, Mr. Murdoch?
Are we married now, Mr. Murdoch? Aye, lad, you're married.
The bride!
Thank you. for ye will not find a laddie.
I go down the creek, and my God for thee must own in it.
Search the hill to the peak, find him lad, and tomorrow is never, never come.
Clear to me.
Why?
Because
I have the peculiar sensation. I'm hearing my own secret being told.
You mean you think you're in love with me?
Think? What good does thinking do? If I thought about it, it wouldn't make any more sense than the miracle. But what I feel is something else.
What do you feel then, Tommy?
This is hard to say, but as I wandered through the leaf, I felt for just a fleeting moment that I suddenly was free of being lonely. Then I closed my eyes and saw the very reason why. I saw a man with his head held low. His heart had no place to go. I looked and I thought to myself,
oh,
May McGee and Sam McGee were a real win in the hall. When finally my father came, his eyes were red, his nose was lit. He said, now even all his name, he was drunkest of them all. The people were lying all over the room and looking as if they were dead. Then mother uncovered the minister, quickened to told him, go ahead. So Pa kneeled down on Bill McCrae, and Martha kneeled on John McCrae. The preacher stood on John McCrae, that's how my ma was wed. It was a sight beyond compare. I ought to know, for I was there.
My dear boy, that's because this is one day. Don't you realize if you stay here, it's for always?
I know.
And you know how long always is around here? It's one hell of a long time.
I know.
This can't be a trial marriage. You can't just change your mind after trying it out for 600 or 700 years.
I won't ever want to.
You're absolutely positive that there'll never come a time when you miss your family, your friends, the life you belong to? How can you know that now?
Because, well, here's where I know you're going to think I'm crazy. Because I believe in her. And what's more, I believe in this place.
You do not. You just want to. This Highland voodoo town makes no more sense to you than it does to me. So how can you believe in it when you don't understand it? When you leave here, in a few weeks, or even a few days, you'll forget all about it. You won't feel a thing. That's the way a dream is.
What do you mean, dream?
That's what this is, a dream. By now you're not really moved by it. You just think you are.
How do you know?
Because I do. Did you see that funeral there a moment ago?
Yes. Why?
I'm responsible for it.
What do you mean?
Harry Ritchie, I killed him.
You did what?
I killed him. Accidentally, of course, but nevertheless, I killed him. Out in the forest tonight, I suddenly saw him rush past me from behind a tree. Without even thinking what I was doing, I pushed him and down he went. And I heard his head hit off a rock with an ugly thud.
My God, Jeff. I'm so sorry.
What for?
You must feel half dead inside.
On the contrary, I don't feel a thing.
You really don't feel anything?
Nothing, except like going home.
Well, why don't you?
Because this is a dream. A good one for you and a bad one for me.
Wait a minute, will you?
You see, I've confused you, haven't I?
Yes, you have.
And if you really believed as much as you think you do, I couldn't do that. I'll wait for you outside the village.
Fiona tells me you want to stay alive.
What is it, Tommy?
It's no good, Fiona. I'm leaving. And it isn't because I don't love you. I think I do. But I guess I just don't trust my own feelings.
You mean you're not sure you can accept everything?
That's about it.
You better hurry, Fiona. There's not much time left. Don't be ashamed of yourself, Tommy. It's the hardest thing in the world to give up everything. Even though it's usually the only way to get everything.
Do you understand at all?
Thank you.
the end of our day.
Sorry, Fiona. Today I had to have
no fears, no doubts. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Tommy. And never forget any day, any night. But always and always, I love you. I love you. I love you.
Thousand miles away with her. Then slowly, I come back to the conversation. They ask me a question, and I don't know what the hell they've been talking about. I didn't hear a word.
You must be fascinating company.
When I'm alone, it's easier.
Tommy! What a wonderful surprise!
Hello, Jay.
Hello, Jay.
When did you get back?
Oh, hello, Jet.
Short while ago.
How are you, Jake?
I've been worried half to death about you.
Oh, fine, Jeff. How are you?
Let me look at you.
Oh, I've had a little cold, but other than that...
I must say, you do look well.
So do you.
Well, I don't want to eat and run. I think I'll go up to my room and have a drink.
See you later, Jeff.
Hello.
Goodbye. Put it on the bill, Frank.
Your bill, sir, is awfully high.
So am I.
Tommy, why didn't you write me?
Nothing to say, I guess. A drink?
Fine, Warren. Well, why didn't you worry? You were getting in town. After all, darling, it didn't take a minute to get in. You call me or come to me and...
Thank you.
I told you we'd call.
I can hardly wait.
Please do. I'm trying so hard to arrange everything. Do you still want Jeff to stand up for you?
Yes, if he can.
It's just that he's so impossible these days. Everybody's bored to death with him.
I'm not interested in everybody, especially the everybody we know.
Well, you've certainly been anti-social since you returned from Scotland. If you really want to avoid everybody, why don't we take Mr. Jackson's house? It's far away and right on top of a high, beautiful hill. And all around it...
It's awful. Awful and unbelievable.
What's awful and unbelievable?
To think that somewhere out there, between the mists and the stars, there's somebody I want so terribly. She's not dead. She's only asleep. And yet I'll never see her again.
Did you bring me all the way over here just to say that? You could have told me that on the phone in New York for a nickel.
No. I'll tell you why. She became so real to me that I had to come back and see for myself that the place really wasn't there. It didn't happen that way for me. It's so much like a dream now that I'd have to work hard just to convince myself it happened at all.
There is the big difference between us.
Tell me about it. I found out that things you believe in become more real than all the things you can explain away or understand. God, why do people have to lose things to find out what they really mean?
Oh, come on, take a last look and let's start walking. I got lost around here once.
Okay.
My great pleasure to welcome you here in such great numbers to this show tonight and to hope you enjoyed the show. The last night of the opera is traditionally a night for the parents of the cast, and I would particularly like to welcome you here and to say how proud you must be of your sons and daughters for the marvelous show they put on tonight. two things I think that people have mentioned to me about this show in the last couple of nights are the talent and the hard work that have gone into it. And I would just like to pay a brief word of thanks to the many people who contributed to that. The orchestra, with many old friends and some new friends, who always contribute so much to our shows. I would like to thank all the teachers and students who did so much work out of sight in sets and lighting and things like that, in arranging the hall and getting you seated, and so many different ways that make putting on this show possible for everybody who comes to it. I thank them very much. I would particularly like to congratulate and thank the producer of the show, Joe Donahue. And I congratulate those teachers who gave so much time to the musical preparation, the musical director, Father Seamus Conan, Sister Eileen, and Noel Curran. I would like, of course, most importantly, to thank and to congratulate the members of the cast. I hope that they realise that they are pleased with their efforts and that they realise how much enjoyment they have given to people here for the last three nights. Before you leave, may I offer the traditional invitation and welcome to the college dining room for a cup of tea, and may I wish you a safe journey home and a happy and a holy Christmas. Thank you very much.
Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. Go home, go home, go home with Bonnie Jean. but friends, when we are wedded to friendship ends, they never come to call. So farewell to one and all, farewell to all the lads I knew.